Good morning.
Morning.
Welcome to our worship service. Thank you for joining us today on this All Saints Sunday, a day where we pay solemn remembrance to our friends and family members and members of this congregation who have died since the last All Saints Sunday. We have 68 names on the list. I don't remember seeing that many names before. That's a lot of people that we lost, and so it apparently was a very difficult year for many of you. Six of those names were members of the congregation. There was Eleanor Ammon was a member, Dan Foltz, Sue Campbell, Don Johnson, Harold Gardner, and the sweet lady that we just lost a week ago, Tori Guy. She died Monday. Most of you probably heard that. Her funeral is tomorrow. There's a showing here at the church from noon to 2. The service then starts at 2 o'clock. We'll then go out to Bellefontaine Cemetery for a committal and then return here. And everyone is invited back here for a dinner. And so I wanted to thank everyone who got that all together so quickly. We've got everything's all ready to go. And I know it's a weekday, but I hope that a lot of you will be able to make that for Tori. A couple of seminars coming up for which there are sheets in the upper narthex. One is called Healthy Functioning in a Pandemic World. That is set for Saturday, November 13th, and you can either attend in person at Good Shepherd Lutheran down in Beaver Creek, or you can attend by Zoom. There is also a seminar called Surviving the Holidays on November 22nd and 23rd. Help for those who are dealing with grief during the holidays, and there's a flyer for that in the upper narthex as well.
And you can call me if you want information about that. It's actually only one of those. It's either Monday morning or Tuesday night.
Oh, thank you. Okay.
So call me if you have questions.
Thank you, Rick. Next Sunday, we have another intergenerational Bible study on the women of the Bible, and that'll be in the lounge, so join us for that. That'll be fun. A couple other dates coming up. The joint Thanksgiving service with the four Lutheran churches, that is Tuesday, November 22nd, the 23rd, excuse me, and this year it is at Galilee Lutheran in Brussels Point, and that's at 7 p.m. If you'd like to sing in the choir for that, we're meeting at 6 o'clock to sing the choir anthem. And then the 28th is the first Sunday of Advent. And right after that service, we will be decorating the church for Christmas. We usually don't do it this early. We usually wait till the second Sunday. But we're doing it on the first Sunday because later that week, on Friday, December 3rd, in addition to the parade downtown, there will be a tour of churches. A tour, people can take tours of the four churches downtown. Our church, the Methodist Church, the Presbyterian Church, and the First Christian Church. And so we'd like to have the sanctuary done up nice for Christmas. So if anyone can stay after the service on the 28th to help decorate the church, we would greatly appreciate that. The more hands we have, the quicker it takes. I believe those are all the announcements, and so now we continue the service with the prayer.
Thank you.
invite you to stand as you are able and face the baptism. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Have mercy on us, O God. We confess that we have sinned against you and against our neighbor. We have built walls instead of gates and have turned away the stranger. We have sought glory for ourselves and have treasured that which does not satisfy. Help us to love as you love, to welcome those you send, and to treasure mercy and justice. God, who makes all things new, forgives your sins for Jesus' sake and remembers them no more. Lift up your heads and your hearts. Yours is the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Note for the opening hymn, we all sing verses 1 and 2, women sing verse 3, men sing verse 4, choir sings verse 5, and then we'll all sing verses 6 and 7.
Thank you.
Almighty God, you have knit your people together in one communion in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Grant us grace to follow your blessed saints in lives of faith and commitment, and to know the inexpressible joys you have prepared for those who love you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen.
First reading is from Isaiah, the 25th chapter, beginning with the 6th verse. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a rich feast of food, a feast of well-aged wines, a rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wine streamed clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
City, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, see, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away. And the one who was seated on the throne said, see, I am making all things new. Also he said, write this, for these words are trustworthy and true. Then he said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
They said to him, Lord, come and see. Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and the stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench, because he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. As Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I know that you always hear me. But I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you have sent me." When he had said this, he cried out with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, his hands and his feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. On this All Saints Sunday, we remember the lives of our friends and family members who have died in the past year. This is one of 2 days in the year that we traditionally must come face to face with our own mortality, the other being Ash Wednesday. And we all understand that death is an ever-present reality in our world, and it will be that way for as long as we are on this side of the kingdom. We all know we're going to die someday, but we hope in the meantime to have an abundant life, well lived, hopefully one that lasts a long time. One of the saints we're honoring today is Harold Gardner. Harold lived to be 100 years old. In fact, he died on his 100th birthday. He died peacefully in his sleep. While I'm sure that Harold's family mourned his passing, no one shook their fist at God and said, "Why?" He was 100. That's the best we can hope for on this side of the kingdom. The death only comes after we have lived a long, full life. So as individuals, we often engage in activities to ensure that we have an opportunity to live a long, healthy, happy life. Hopefully we're exercising, eating right, following our doctor's orders, quitting smoking, drinking only in moderation, if at all, taking our medicines, wearing our seatbelts, and so forth. Sometimes we do things to try to ignore the reality that we're getting older. There's a show on television I've begun to enjoy. It's called Be Positive. A new character to the show this season is a character named Bette, who's a resident in an assisted living facility where the lead character works. Jane Seymour plays the character. You might remember her from Dr. Quinn, the medicine. Now, Bette is very evidently trying to ignore the reality that she's getting older. She wears a long-haired blonde wig that's obviously fake, and wears clothing more appropriate for someone in her 20s than in her 70s. Tight-fitting clothes, leather pants, short skirts, and so on. And if you know Jane Seymour, you know that the actress herself doesn't need to do any of that. She's still a beautiful woman. But like her character, some of us will do things like dye our hair or use Rogaine to regrow our hair, or try anti-aging creams, or even sometimes take Botox injections to try to look younger. We do this partly for our mental health, to look better and hopefully then feel better about ourselves. There's nothing wrong with any of that. But I can't help thinking that we also do these things because we're trying to put off thinking about our own mortality. And it's a lot easier to do that if we look younger. In today's readings, all three of our main readings have two things in common. The first is that they all acknowledge the very present reality of death. Now, we're fortunate that we live in a smaller community where the murder rate is very low. Standard of living is pretty good. Most people in the world live in a place where death is constantly at the door. Imagine what it would be like to live in a country being torn apart by war, say Syria or the occupied West Bank of Israel, or Yemen, or South Sudan, where every day there's a very real danger of you being killed by a bomb blast or a drone strike. Imagine living in the inner city of any place in the United States where crime and gang and some violence is an everyday occurrence. Chicago, South Central Los Angeles, St. Louis, even Washington, D.C. Places where the murder rate is high, where even walking to school can be dangerous. And of course, war and murder are not the only things that bring death. Today, we live in a world of COVID-19. This global pandemic so far has killed 5 million people around the world, 750,000 of them here in the United States. And we face death from drug overdoses, from cancer, from heart attacks, from car accidents. And even in small communities like Logan County, Ohio, death is a very real presence. In Paul's writings, especially in his letter to the Romans and to the Corinthians, Paul does not see death as merely a natural biological condition. He views death as an enemy, a malevolent force that takes pleasure in destroying things. Paul doesn't see death as the opposite of life. He sees death, with a capital D, as the enemy of life. And since Jesus tells us that he is the way and the truth and the life, then death is seen as an enemy of Jesus, an enemy of God. Paul tells us that the last enemy that will be destroyed is death, and also that death will be swallowed up in victory. That is the second commonality of these three readings. God is seen, and Jesus Christ is seen as being the enemy of death, with God on a mission to destroy death forever. Today in our world, most of the major social issues that we fight about the most touch on issues of life and death. When should we go to war? The death penalty, abortion, the right to die laws, just to name a few. Right now, there is pending in the Ohio legislature a bill that would outlaw the death penalty in this state, and it has a great deal of bipartisan support. These issues are controversial because the stakes are so very high, literally about life and death. I remember when I was on internship and I was teaching a confirmation class, we had a group of ninth graders, and we were discussing the morality of the right to die laws that started in Oregon and now are in several states. And those laws typically say that if you have two independent doctors confirm that you have an illness or a disease that will result in your death within 6 months, and if they find you to be of sound mind, then you can decide to die. One of the students said she would never agree to anything like that. "I want to be kept alive for as long as possible," she said. And she joked, "Plug me into the cigarette lighter of the car if you have to, but don't let me die." Later, I gave her a copy of that famous poem by Dylan Thomas, the one that goes, "Do not go gentle into that good night. Rage, rage against the dying of the light." She saw death as an enemy that needed to be kept at bay for as long as possible. And as a society, I think we do treat death as the enemy, and rightly so. You know, when I was in the hospital earlier this year with kidney stones, I would get very annoyed because every time a nurse or a doctor or a healthcare professional would come into the room, they would look at my chart and ask, "What's your name? What's your date of birth? What procedure are you having done today?" And all of this is information right there on the chart that they're reading as they're asking me the questions. Why do they do this? Well, it's simple. They don't want me to die. They don't want to just assume that whoever wrote the information on the chart got it right. They double check and they triple check, because if someone made a mistake, if the chart said I was there to get my appendix out instead of a kidney stone, someone might give me the wrong medication and it might kill me. And yes, the motives are mixed. I'm sure part of it is to avoid getting sued, but the main motivator is my life. And when a police officer pulls me over for speeding, I get annoyed and wonder why they're not out there catching real criminals. I need to be reminded that while, again, motives may be mixed, and I'm sure part of the reason for speeding tickets is to raise income for the city, the main motivation is to avoid death, because a speeding driver, just like a drunk driver or a driver under the influence of drugs, is more likely to cause an accident resulting in my death or the death of other people or both. And we've all heard this about this horrible accident a few weeks ago on a movie set where a cinematographer was tragically killed when the actor Alec Baldwin fired a gun that he assumed had only blanks. But in fact, there was a live bullet in the chamber. If the studio had followed the same procedure that the hospitals do, then three different people, the armorer who handed the gun to the assistant director who handed the gun to Alec Baldwin, and Alec Baldwin himself would have all checked that gun. They might have grumbled about it, thought it was redundant, unnecessary, a waste of time, just like I felt when I was in the hospital getting asked the same questions over and over. But nobody would have died that day. We know that we can't escape death on this side of the kingdom, but we treat death as the enemy and attempt to delay it for as long as possible. I've spoken about what we do as individuals to delay death for as long as possible, but this is the mission of the church as well. As a church, we are called to take steps to end poverty and homelessness and hunger and addiction and other afflictions that shorten life. We want our leaders to work for peace in the world. We want to end disease. Another saint we honor today is Tori. Tori was just 35. That's much too soon to die. Her obituary stated in part, "Tori has been a passionate advocate for metastatic breast cancer and has worked at the local, state, and national levels to bring awareness of MBC, as well as change in funding and legislation." We should all be so dedicated, because on this side of the kingdom, we work to create a world where the only people who die are people like Harold, who lived to a ripe old age and died peacefully in their sleep. On the other side of the kingdom, ever since the first sin brought death into the world, God has seen death as the enemy and has taken steps to destroy death forever. The Isaiah passage speaks of a world where God will swallow up death forever. This is a reference to Canaanite mythology. The Canaanite god of death, named Mot, was a monster who swallowed his victims. In mythology, Mot even swallows Baal, the Canaanites' most powerful god. Now he escapes when Baal's lover, the goddess Anat, slices Mot in two, freeing Baal, and then she grinds him up. But much like a villain in the Terminator movies, Mot doesn't die. He just kind of, you know, repairs himself and continues to exist. But God tells the prophet Isaiah that one day God will swallow the swallower, and in some wonderful bit of karma, destroy death forever. Then we have the Revelation passage, speaking of a time when God will descend and live with his people. Heaven and earth will be transformed and death will be no more. And then we have the gospel reading, the resurrection of Lazarus. When told that Lazarus is dead, Jesus weeps. Why does Jesus weep? If he knows he has the power over death, if he knows that he can restore Lazarus to life, why does he weep? He weeps because Mary and Martha are weeping. He weeps because he knows the pain and the anguish that death causes us, and he weeps with us and shares his grief with us. Lazarus was Jesus' friend, and Jesus loved him. So yes, Jesus weeps as well. But then he shows that he has power over sin and death by resurrecting Lazarus. And of course, this is a foreshadowing of Jesus' own death and resurrection. For Jesus is the resurrection and the life, and all who believe in him will never die, but have eternal life. This is the hope on which our faith stands. We know that those we love, through faith in Christ, do live on and will live on, for we have a God who treats death as the enemy, and who, through Christ's death and resurrection, conquers death forever. We are all, as Martin Luther said, simultaneously saint and sinner. Sinners by what we do, saints by what God has done for us, by conquering death and giving us eternal life. Soli Deo Gloria, to God alone be the glory. We remember the great ancestors of our faith, from Abraham and Sarah to Peter and Mary Magdalene.
Ancestors of faith, we remember you.
We remember the prophets and priests, the ministers and teachers who have taught us the way of God.
Teachers of faith, we remember you.
We remember our grandparents and parents, aunts and uncles, and those who have gone before us in our lifetime.
Family of faith, we remember you.
We lift up the memories of children, grandchildren, siblings and cousins, spouses and parents whose lives ended too soon. We lift up the pain of pregnancy and infant loss, often carried silently, trusting that you hold all children in your love.
Those close to our heart, we remember you.
We lift up to you, O God, the names of those we have lost in this past year from our lives, knowing that they are in your heart forever. As we read these names, we'll pause after each name to remember, pray, give thanks for their life. Lucille Abels.
Eleanor Ammon.
Willie Anderson.
Suzanne Antrim.
Jerry Belt.
Joe Ferry.
Angelo Bernard.
Eddie Beth.
David Allen Blair.
William Blair.
Robert Brown.
Sue Campbell.
Donald Bill Culp.
Patrick Dodds.
Eugene Downing.
Sandra Duff.
Donald Eggenschmeyer.
Robert Fuller.
Dan Foltz.
Bradford Gamble.
Harold Gardner.
Eileen Foltz Galt.
Victoria Tori Guy.
Robert Eatson.
Bob Rumley.
Chelsea Harmon.
Duane Harmon.
Joe Hoff.
Tim Hill.
Joyce Hoffman.
Alberta Jacobs.
Martha James.
Don Colonel Johnson.
Louis Rocky Jones.
Dustin Kennedy.
Laura Rebecca Kohler.
Dale Kramer.
Susan Lehman.
Donald Little.
Carol Llewellyn.
Linda Lockwood.
Frank Madonia.
Arthur Eugene Marine.
Alex McLean.
Helen McCoy.
Nick McGuire.
Jewel Miller.
Norman Bill Miller.
Robert Miller.
Sarah May Miller.
Betty Murray.
Anthony Lynn Pitcock.
Peggy Pittman.
Pamela K. Pond.
John Porter.
John David Reynolds.
Eric Roberts.
Reva Robinson.
Donald Shirk.
Stephen Skidmore.
Christina Snap.
Richard Strayer.
Russell Tanger.
Margaret Peggy Thackeray.
Terry Lee Willoughby.
Kay Rowe.
We celebrate the lives of those we have named, O God, and lift up many more names in our hearts.
Comfort us in our grief, and strengthen our faith, that we may be united at the peace of every
We lift up to you, O God, the names of those who have been baptized into Jesus Christ, knowing that they belong to you as children of the kingdom, and trusting that when you call us children of God, that is what we are. We give thanks, O God, for all who have gone on to join with you beyond this life, and for all who walk as yet by faith and not by sight. We trust in the hope of resurrection and the promise of new life in Christ, and know that in our grief and celebration, O God, you are with us through it all. We are not left alone. We anticipate the day when every tear will be wiped from our eyes, and we shall gather around the throne of God with all the saints. In the name of Christ, in whom love lives forever, we pray.
Amen.
Please stand as you are able as we sing the hymn.
Thank you.
Let us confess our faith, the faith in which we are baptized, using the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please keep in your thoughts and prayers those suffering with various health issues. Eric Duncan, Beth Novak, Peggy Ackerman, Marge McGilvery, Dave Anderson, those recovering from surgery, Jean Wright, and our sister who has entered the church triumphant, Tori Guy. Eternal God, you hold firm amid the changes of this world. Hear us now as we pray for the church, the world, and everyone in need. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of abundance, we praise you for the feeding ministries and for all meals that bring people together for nourishment and fellowship. Bless chefs, bakers, servers, dishwashers, communion assistants, and meal ministry coordinators. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of justice, we pray for all those newly elected or re-elected to political office this past Tuesday. Move their hearts to work for justice and peace, with special attention given to the poor and the marginalized. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of the ages, we give you thanks for the saints of this congregation who have inspired, challenged, loved, and taught us. Wipe away our tears and lead us by their example until we feast together on your holy mountain. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God, our protection and strength, we entrust to you all for whom we pray. always, through Jesus Christ our Savior.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Yes, sir. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Remembering therefore his salutary command, his life-giving passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and the promise of his coming again, we give thanks to you, O Lord God Almighty, not as we ought, but as we are able. We ask you mercifully to accept our praise and thanksgiving, and with your word and Holy Spirit to bless us, your servants, and these, your own gifts of bread and wine, so that we and all who share in the body and blood of Christ may be filled with heavenly blessing and grace, and receiving the forgiveness of sin, may be formed to live as your holy people, and given our inheritance with all your saints. To you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all glory and honor in your holy church, now and forever.
Thank you. stand as you're able. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Extend our tables and to share your gifts until that day when all feast together at your heavenly banquet.
Amen.
God, who is the beginning and the end, who has written your name in the book of life, bless you and keep you in grace and peace from this time forth and forevermore.
Amen.
Led on by the saints before us, go in peace.